Tonight we will hear the story of Jesus' journey to the cross and worship as we remember his greatest sacrifice done for us out of God's great love for each of us. In the beginning of creation, God announced with light, as it is written in Genesis, "Let there be light," and there was light. And it was good. From that time, to be with God was to be in the light, and the absence of light was sin and death, where God was not. Isaiah writes, "Come, let us walk in the light of the Lord." God is light, but we feel the shadows creeping in, and our hearts cry out, "You have seen my suffering. O Lord, do not be silent. O Lord, do not be far from me. Do not let the night consume us." On this night of remembering Christ's death, we wait for God to speak. We look for the light of resurrection to dispel the night of death. We will hear the story of Jesus Christ, God's light to the nations, who dwelt among us and for our sake, because we could not, took on the shadows of our lives and the sting of death's night. In Jesus Christ, God entered our darkness. In Jesus Christ, God embraced the full depths of the night. There is no darkness untouched by God and by God's light in Christ. That light is symbolized by the light of the Christ candle. Throughout the year, and when we are baptized, and so we gather around the font, remembering this light, the light of Christ that makes us whole and gives us strength. As the prophet Isaiah proclaimed, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined." Jesus Christ is the light of the world, the light no darkness could overcome. We are the ones who dwell in the shadows, who dwell in darkness, and yet in hope. On this holy night, we will journey together through darkness and light. We will join in song and in prayer, in hope and in love. And we will hear anew the story of Christ's saving love. There will be singing and silence. Please join us in singing together whenever you see the lyrics on the screen. And as we prepare to hear God's story, which is also our story, I invite you to pray with me now as we begin this night's worship, as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, forever and ever. Amen. We gather to worship in the name of the living God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us hear the story with new ears and fresh eyes this holy night as we begin our worship together in song.
Reading of the Passion of Christ this evening comes from Mark's Gospel, beginning of chapter 14, verse 26. When they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all become deserters, I will not."
But Jesus said to him,
"Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But he said vehemently,
"Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you."
And all of them said the same.
I will not deny you.
I will not deny you.
I will not deny you.
They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took with him Peter and James and John, and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me. Yet, not what I want, but what you want." He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak." And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough! The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let's be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Go to dark Gethsemane, all who feel the tempter's power, your Redeemer's conflict see. Wash with him one bitter hour, turn not from his grief.
Immediately while he was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, and with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
"The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard."
So when he came, he went up to him at once and said,
"Rabbi,"
and kissed him. Then the two laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them,
"Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as if I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled."
All of them deserted him and fled.
They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying,
"We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another not made with hands.'"
But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
"Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?"
But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
"Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Jesus said,
"I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power, and coming with the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?"
All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him,
"Prophesy."
The guards also took him over it and beat him.
While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said,
"You also were with Jesus, the man of from Nazareth."
But he denied it, saying,
"I do not know or understand what you are talking about."
And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
But again he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter,
"Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean."
But he began to curse, and he swore an oath,
"I do not know this man you are talking about."
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." And he broke down and wept.
As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He answered him,
"You say so."
Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again,
"Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you."
But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, he was used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels, who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again.
"Then what do you wish for me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted back,
"Crucify him!"
Pilate asked them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
"Crucify him!"
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified.
Calvary's mournful mountain climb, there adoring at his feet, mark that miracle of time, God's own sacrifice complete, it is finished, hear him cry, learn from Jesus Christ to die.
Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. They began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him.
Mm-hmm.
They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull, and they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscriptions of the charges against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on the left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads, saying, "Aha, you who would destroy the temples and build it in 3 days. Save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying, "He saves others, he cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of the cross now, so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh,
when it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why hast thou forsaken?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now, when the centurion, who stood facing him, saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was God's son."
When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, A respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph brought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth, and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus, saw where the body was laid.
Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble.